good morning. Welcome in. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Well, as we enter into this time of praise and worship, why don't you stand with us and sing to our one amazing God that we love and serve this morning. I like to think that we're all friends here this morning. Are we all friends? Moment of honesty. Are we all friends? How many of you got up this morning and you woke up and you got yourself dressed and you looked at the clock and you went, oh, I got a whole another hour I could have slept in. Anybody like that this morning? Am I the only one? I mean, I got a two-year-old that decided he was coming in at 6:45 this morning because I guess two-year-olds don't believe in time change. Well, it's good to be here this morning. It's good to be as we turn the page from our outreach month into November. If you've been on our Facebook page, if you're on Facebook, I encourage you to follow us at Heritage Memorial Church. If you got on Facebook this week, you saw Sylvia do a neat little video kind of introducing this week's sermon, this month's sermon series entitled Dangerous Prayers. I'm excited for it, aren't you? Excited to see where God can take us this morning, this month. God search you this morning. So sing with us as Sue leads us this morning.
Free. sets free. Born is free indeed. I'm the child of God. Yes, I am.
Give Him praise this morning.
Trying to open every door, search near and far, turning over every stone. I close my eyes, still I find no rest, no rest for a restless heart. 'Cause all I've been chasing, putting my faith in, let it fade, let it break into pieces, and just give me Jesus. Just give me Jesus. Oh, there's nothing I desire that can be found in you. You're everything that I've ever needed. Just give me Jesus. Take all my pride, my dreams, my plans, built on troubled sand. If I gave the world, it would never be. It would never be enough. Just give me Jesus.
That out this morning. Just give me Jesus.
Just give me Jesus.
Jesus.
Just give me Jesus.
Jesus.
Very simple. Just give me.
Just give me Jesus.
Jesus.
Just give me Jesus.
God, as we come this morning, that's my simple prayer. God, it's so easy just to cram my life all this stuff that I think I need. But it's just you. Just give me you. Because that's our prayer this morning, that you would search me. Reveal to me the things that I don't need. When all I need is you, I put my faith in you. I pray these things in Jesus' name. This morning,
'cause I've been held by the Savior.
All of heaven and all of earth good. Lord, we thank you for Jesus, our Savior, through whom we all are restored back to you and we are made children of God. Lord, thank you for your Holy Spirit, whose presence and power fills our hearts and lives and our churches. Lord, have mercy on us and refresh us with minds that rest in you and your will alone. Lord, eyes that have been touched by your hand, that we might see and join in your mission in our midst. Ears open to hear the voices of others who hunger and long for righteousness and restoration. And Lord, give us mouths unashamed to share how you have personally transformed our hearts. And Lord, give us hands ready and able to accomplish the work that you have set before us. And Lord, give us feet that gladly and promptly walk to where you have directed us. And Lord, as we begin to focus this month on the power of our prayers, Lord, we humbly ask that you would search us, O God, and know our hearts. Test us and know our anxious thoughts. And Lord, see if there would be any offensive way in us. And Lord, that you would lead us in the way everlasting. And we pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. To everyone watching live stream and all of you here, welcome home. Yes, that was awesome. If you're here for the first time or the first time in a long time, we are glad that you're here. And if you would, please fill out one of the yellow welcome cards. And after the service, if you turn that into the welcome center in the foyer, we have a gift for you just to show you how much we appreciate you being here with us this morning. As the ushers begin to come, and right before we receive the tithes and offerings, so just a few quick reminders. Tonight at 6 is a baptism service. Baptism's a big deal. Amen? So we should celebrate it as such. Amen? Good. So I should see all of you here this evening at 6 o'clock for the baptism service to encourage those who are being baptized, to celebrate with those who are being baptized, our family members, our brothers and sisters in Christ. This is a big deal. They're making a public profession of their faith in Christ in front of friends and family and the people of our church. So let's show up and show them our support. What do you say? Not so many amens when I told you you're all... Yeah, there we go. Also, there's going to be a brief meeting right after this service of our church board. We'll be meeting in the typical church room. It's like a bat cave, just so you know. It's very secretive. No, it's just one of the Sunday school classrooms. So, board members, just a quick meeting after service reminder. Also, Fully Alive tomorrow at 6:30. Right, Linda? Amen. And desserts for sale by Fully Alive. After service, foyer? And in the foyer? Okay. Desserts for sale. They're good. I saw them. I didn't eat any. Just before we give this morning, think about this. Examples are few of men ruined by giving. May the Lord bless the offering.
Hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you. And a friend who understands everything you're going through.
Feel free to sing along if you know it. But you keep standing.
Distance in the shadow of your shame, but there's a light of hope that's shining. Wanna come and take your place and bring it all to the table. Take it all.
the Savior and He comes. Bring it all to the table.
Bring it all.
Bring it all to the table.
One more time, bring it all to the table.
Bring it all to the table.
We get to do something cool today. We're going to dedicate a child. Amen. Everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
We're talking about families. Layla Marie Ellis is her name. If they would come this morning, they're in the way. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Do let them know you appreciate them this morning, dedicating their children. Hey, 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 family can come. Those that are family and support, you're welcome to join them if that's okay with them. Hey guys, check out the dress. That is so cool. Come on up here if you will. Oh man. Yes. Amen. Look at her. Hey guys, thank you for coming. You know, a baby dedication is unique. Now, this is just a second. A baby dedication is unique. And the fact that this doesn't save the child. But what it does is, it's a promise of those who love this child. We'll bring them up in the wisdom and the admonition of the Lord. And so this dedication really is of them. And to pray, but we're going to pray that God would bless that child. And would make that child just a fantastic, come on, a fantastic child. So would you allow me to pray, would you please? And I'll take this. And because children often cry in my arms, okay, I'm going to pray, okay? Lord, thank you for Layla. God, what a beautiful child. Yeah. Lord Jesus, thank you. That Lord, we're going to believe that you have already planned for her something so cool and awesome. And thank you, Lord, for her inquisitive spirit. Thank you, God, for the love that I sense up here on the platform. Bless Layla. Lord, make her become an unbelievable blessing to people, an unbelievable blessing to the kingdom, and God, an unbelievable child of Christ. May Christ be seen in her life early so that God, she would say yes to Jesus and no to the world. Okay. And we ask this in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit. And everybody said, amen. Amen. She's got to have this flower, man. You got. So here, I'll let you hold that. All right. Listen, how many of you right now in your heart, pray in your heart, and if God brings them to your remembrance, that you'll lift them up in the things of God, would you make them again welcome this morning and thank God you guys have done this. God bless you, man. Well, thank you for being here. God bless you, guys. God bless you. God bless you. See you, honey.
Bye-bye.
See you, man. Thanks, guys. God bless.
Heavenly Father, as hard as this is for me, I'm asking you to search me. Search me, God, and know my heart. God, test my motives. Reveal to me my anxious thoughts. Show me anything in me that offends you. God, I want to see in me what you see in me, so I can become more like Jesus. God, I ask you to search me.
As you already know, the bulletin has already shared with you that there's a new series. Obviously, if you've been around long enough, you'll know that every month we make a theme and an emphasis. And the theme and emphasis for this month is dangerous prayers. And we're gonna talk over the next several weeks about these prayers. They are dangerous prayers. Today it's search me. Next week it's going to be break me. Yeah, I knew that we'd get that response from Robin. I can always count on Robin to give us whoa kind of a thing. Amen. Well, she's my amen corner along over here over these days. But then it's going to be lead me, then use me. Okay? And every week there's going to be a different video from somebody within our congregation. Make sure you're on Facebook, because on Facebook this week it was Sylvia. Sylvia shared her heart. But next week we have, I'm telling you, these are stories you want to hear.
and be on Facebook, because you'll get to hear them talk about the prayer of the week. Okay? And also, if you really believe in prayer, how many of you would like to move mountains in your life? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Come and get a honk. Come on, come on, honk. Okay. Those who are familiar with John Eldridge, great author, men's books in the past, Wild at Heart, some just great stuff. He has written a book called Moving Mountains, Praying with Passion, Confidence, and Authority. So I really hope that you will take the time. If you're looking for something to read and to follow along thematically with the series, I encourage you to come and be a part of that. Today I want to talk about dangerous prayers, and specifically, search me. I will let you know that not everybody is probably going to pray this prayer. It's when you say it's dangerous prayer right away, we're trying to let you know that if you pray this prayer, it will rock your world. Okay? But it's rocking it upward. Does that make sense? If you're willing to pray this prayer, search me, it will remove, it will take men from boys to giants. It will take girls to righteous women. This particular prayer that we're going to talk about today should absolutely scare you, but should absolutely compel you. Search me. And the prayer of the day is really, really, well, let me just get to, in other words, guys, mealtime, bedtime, business as usual prayers, guess what? It's not enough. It's for those who want to know why they have a wall that they can't break. It's for those who find themselves in spiritual dryness, and they're wanting to know, God, why is it that this isn't progressing in my life? It's going to have to be a prayer that you say, God, then you're going to have to find it. Here in a second, in Psalm 139, and verse 23 and 24, we're going to hear David cry out the very same prayer. And there's a reason why, and I'll share that. But as we're heading that way, let's just do something. Let's determine today to stop dog paddling in the shallow end. Let's plunge into the deep. And why would you pray this prayer? Maybe some of you are saying, Pastor, why in the world would you ask us to pray a prayer that's dangerous? Here's why. Freedom. Freedom. How many of you want to be spiritually free? Somebody where it's no longer, oh God, where are you? But it's, God, despite my circumstances, I feel this thing underneath me holding me up, plunging there, and it's taking me to a greater place because I have asked you to look deeply. So today I want to ask you this. Give God the keys to every room in your life, every one of them. Freedom from the enemy's roadblocks and chains. I mean, the kind of prayers that Jabez prayed, who basically said, God, enlarge my borders and bless me. But basically his prayer was, my name means bringing pain. So God, don't let me bring pain. You ever pray that prayer? Think about this. God, don't let me be somebody's problem. How many of you think Jonah prayed in the belly room? Or Elijah? Or Hannah when she prayed over her child? See, the Bible's full of these. But what I'm getting at for this month is the Christian life is not about playing it safe. It's about living life on the edge. Now, Pastor, again, you say, Pastor, what do you mean by dangerous prayers? No, I'm not saying that something good, bad is going to happen. It doesn't mean lightning's going to strike or the sky is going to fall. But dangerous prayers, my friends, are those that reach the heart of God. They're prayed by ordinary people just like you and me. And you see, prayer is for everybody. Can I say it again? Prayer is for everybody. Hey, did I happen to tell you that prayer is for everybody? And you and I have this awesome privilege. We can pray to the Lord anytime, anywhere. It's a privilege that none of us should take for granted. So whether you're a seasoned prayer or a beginner, thank God that we have prayer. But let's now look at this. Let's look at David's prayer in Psalm 139. It says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, know my anxieties. And see if there's any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Let me explain to you what's happening. Psalm 139 is actually in four parts. David is writing, and he starts out with, "God, you..." Okay, this is my commentary. Okay? But this is what, as I studied this week, the four categories are: God, here's what I know. You're in control. And you know everything. Okay, you got to get this. God, you're in control. Okay? And you know everything. Can you say that with me? God, you're in control. Okay, you know everything. Okay, so I've just given you two of the omnis. Omni, right? Control, omnipotent, all-powerful, in control. Omniscient, knows everything. So here's what he says. And part two is, and you're everywhere. Hey, how many of you know this? You cannot go, run, fly, drive far enough to get away from God. You just can't get away from God. So David, what David is saying is, here's what I know about you, God. You're in charge. You're in control. You know me. You know everything. And I can't run away from you. You're everywhere. So let me just say this. Because I know that I need you to be in charge of my life. And so I've given you part one, two, and three. The last part is this. So God, because I know you're in charge, search me. Look deep into my life. Because God, I want to be a good one. I want to be a good one for you. So with that in mind of the search, search me. There's dozens of different prayers in Scripture that cover these kinds, but this one stands out. Now, what I'd like to do is I'd like to show you a very important tool in my house. I have an attic that has one light, okay, and it's right inside the door. Okay, how my house is set up, there's my bedroom, not like you really need to know this, but bedroom, closet, attic. Okay, you can't get to the attic unless you want to cut a hole in the drywall in the garage. But you can't get there until you go that way. But here's what I know. You flip the light, but here's what happens. If I'm looking for something, I need this. Okay. I've personally fallen through drywall. Okay? Hello? Yeah. I'm sure the only one here in this room. Okay. Oh, we have others. Let's start a support group. But here's what I know. In my attic, there's not enough light. And if I'm looking for something, like Hannah was flying off to Spain. And Hannah, is she's looking for this tea set. Okay? Now, I wasn't present at the house, but here's what I know. When I've been asked the question, is that up in the attic? Ding. And I use this because it's in darkness. Hello. Hi, Chad. Tim. What's up, man? Found ya. Legend. You're the man. Hey, Annie. Sorry. Am I blinding some of you? Thank you. I'm going to keep doing it. Okay. Let me explain something to you. I have found things, tools. I have found objects. Now, you know where I'm headed. The prayer that David prayed was, God, turn on the light and find the stuff that's in the darkness that even I don't see. You do know he knows you better than you. Turn the lights back up. See, his prayer was, God, reveal what I need to see. Some of you are wondering, why is it that certain things trigger my anger? And maybe you're thinking, why am I just like an angry person? If you don't know, God does, and He can help you find it. If there's something in your life that doesn't make sense, or why, God, why is it that I keep hitting this wall and I just can't seem to get past it? I just have a problem that I just can't figure out. Then pray David's prayer. God, turn the flashlight on. Reveal it to me. And really, David actually gives to us a litany or an inventory of how to pray that prayer. And I want to bring it to you today. When we pray, Lord, search me, we're praying for the God of heaven to flash the light of His brilliant holiness into the inner parts and recesses of our soul and expose whatever is there. We're saying, God, shine the spotlight of Your grace into my life, and if there's anything there that shouldn't be there, expose it. Expose it with Your light and get it out in the open. How many of you have ever read Pilgrim's Progress? Okay, Bunyan, and then just, man, some of you, I tell you, this, some of these old classics, it'd be great if you could read them. But I've seen the book and seen the movie. How many of you are like, I'm like a book person. I got to tell you, in both book and movie, there's a part that drives in college. There's a part, the book is really intended to be thematically a spoken word to the church of the day. And Bunyan was talking about this guy named Pilgrim. And he's on this journey to find. And so in the process of journey for looking, he comes across, and he's got this backpack on it. It's, if you see the movie, he's got this really large duffel bag over his shoulder. And as the book is going, and as the movie's going along, more and more heavy burdens are going on inside that bag. And by the time he reaches the point where he can barely, muscle it around, he finally climbs this hill, and it's a steep hill, and he's dragging this thing up till finally he looks at the cross. And when he sees the cross, he lets it go. And man, that bag just rolls all the way down. And I'm thinking to myself, God, that's salvation. That's when you, God, that we reach a point where we say, God, take it all. And God takes it. But it's not just for salvation. Pilgrim was set free. And it took the cross to do it. So as we go through this prayer today, I hopefully have somewhat whet your appetite. Talk to us, Pastor. What is it that I should expect if I pray this prayer? First thing is, Lord, check my heart. Check my heart. And by the way, let me read Jeremiah 17 to you. Before we go any farther, when you think of heart, I don't want you to think of Hallmark. Some of you are already addicted at this point. It's November. And there's not enough G-rated romantic movies for us to contain, so we have to find our home. Am I looking at people that are out there? I know I'm looking at you, Linda. When I start talking about Hallmark, or the heart, should I say, Jeremiah 17 gives us a lowdown on the heart. The human heart is the most deceitful of all things. Hello? And desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? Now let me explain something to you. This verse is basically saying, if there's something bad in somebody's life, you'll find it built and created in the heart. If there's immorality, if there's lust, if there's greed, if there's idolatry, if there's something in your life that's contrary to God, when you say, God, open my heart, God's going to open up all of it, and He's going to say, I see the stuff that you say is Sunday morning church, and I see the stuff there that's there for Sunday school and small groups, but what about a
and you fill in the blank. You see, immorality, unethical behavior, hatred, bitterness, resentment, unforgiveness. That's the stuff Jeremiah's talking about. You see, if God doesn't have all your heart, there's a chance that some of the rest of it will be held close to the devil. By the way, let me just remind you, we were reminded yesterday in men's ministry, if the devil can't make you bad, he'll make you busy. And in that, we have to talk today. God, check my heart out. Open up my heart. Lord, help me to make sure that my heart is good. Wherever your here's another one. It shows the true desire of your heart. Matthew 6:21. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be. It's in your heart that you decide to value things. So if you say, God, search my heart, He's going to say, how are you treating your family? Hey, Lord, check out my heart. He might say this, then why won't you forgive your neighbor? Are you with me? That's why it's a dangerous prayer. If you pray this prayer, God's going to say, okay, you asked for it. Here we go. But let me remind you of what you get when God does it, especially with a willing heart. Freedom! Hey! Hello, hello, Christian man and woman. Freedom. Freedom. God, whom the Son sets free. What is it? It's whom the Son sets free. That's Scripture. So we got Scripture that says the heart is deceitful and it's wicked and it's a bad place. But you've got a Savior over here that if you let Him search your heart and you say, God, search my heart and show me, and I give it to you and He cleanses it, you will be set free. So that's why you say, God, show me my heart. You've got to ask that question. What is the desire of your heart? In Matthew 22:37, you must love the Lord your God with all your and all your and all your mind. Hey, you do know that Doug Carter was right. Years ago when I traveled with him in college, here's what he said. The heart of man's problem is the problem of man's heart. Hello? The heart of our problems. Hello? The heart of our problems is the problem of man's heart. So God, check my heart. That's where the landmines are found, you know. That's where you find the landmine of unforgiveness and the landmine of anger and the landmine of resentment and bitterness. And guess what? When those things are allowed to be in there, they will explode at some point. But Christ, listen, Christ wants to cleanse our hearts. Expose my fears. What makes you most afraid? You see, fear is what creates... I better slow down because I need you to hear this. Fear is what creates spiritual amnesia. See, if you're afraid of something, if you're really afraid of it, that means you're going to concentrate on it. And when you concentrate on it, that means all you can see is the fear. And guess what you no longer see? The miracles of God. You no longer see the stuff that God's already done for you. Because why? You're so focused on the fear. And by the way, what you fear most, go ahead and put it up. What we fear the most reveals where we trust God the least. The number one fear in your life is a spiritual issue. I got to confess that in order for me to preach this message to you, I decided a week ago to start praying it for myself. She's afraid of me. I started praying the prayer, God, search my heart. And I got to be real honest with you. Can I be transparent today?
Yes.
Man, it rocked my world this week. And God opened my eyes to what my number one fear is. Now, I mean, we all have fears, and I have other fears, you know, concerned with family and things like that, you know. But my biggest fear is that I will let people down. That I would fail them. God opened my eyes to my dad. My dad, he was a glass half empty kind of guy. And I was named after him. He was Bruce Sr., I was Bruce Jr. And I worshiped that man. But I could never please him. So this week, all of these memories, praying the prayer, God kind of brought all these memories to me, and all I can remember was trying so hard to please him, and it would never be enough. I'm sorry, and that planted a seed in me that I've been trying as a pastor. In some ways, when I hear criticism, it's like I feel like I need to try harder so that I'll get rid of the criticism. But you know what I realized? The Lord helped me to see in this prayer. I said, God, search my heart, and I don't want to let people down, but here's what God said. You can't please people. There's some people that just won't let me off the hook. I still have people from my past. And if I go to Circleville, they remember what I was. And some of them I could never please. And I got to confess that in the past, I have thought through making decisions as pastor to try to please people. Can I confess that to you? And here's what the Lord told me. Son, you just work on pleasing me. And let me have the rest. I don't know what you're afraid of. Whatever it is, it's where you don't trust God the most. What is it, guys? Maybe you're afraid to even go home at night because you don't have any idea how bad it will be. Some of you get up in the morning and you're headed to work, and you're headed to work knowing that there's a handful of people that don't like you at all at work, and you know you're going to have to cross paths with them in the hallway, and you know that those people are bullying you or mocking you in some way, and maybe that's your fear. Or maybe teenagers, you know, you go to school and you're just sick and tired of the drama. And I know that there's drama. It happens in churches. It happens in schools and colleges. Jobs. It happens in homes. What are you afraid of? I'd like to read to you. You know what the answer to that, the answer to fear is? Scriptural memorization. It's the answer. You want to know why? Because Jesus taught us that. Because the devil in the wilderness was throwing everything he could at Christ. And every time he'd throw, what about the bread and the stones? What was Jesus' response? Thou shalt not. What about jumping off the pinnacle and the angels will catch you? Not going to do it. But you want to know why? Because God is the one who will catch me. And he takes Christ up to the top of the highest point and says, you can have this all. Just bow down. And he will say, I love Jesus' response. your day's coming. In essence, what are you afraid of? The second passage, David, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Hello? Say it with me. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all you do, and He will show you which path to take. And Hebrews 11:6, it's impossible to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to Him must believe that God exists and that He rewards those who sincerely seek Him. If you're afraid of something, know this, the reward from Christ is what you want. And the prayer is also saying, God, illuminate my sins. What is it that's in your life that's inconsistent with God's Word? Anything that displeases God. It's asking God to reveal. Now, let me just kind of give you a handful of these sins. The first one's called respectable sin. Anybody here know what respectable sin is? You say, Pastor, that's impossible. No, it's not, because I hear people say, well, they're doing it. Huh? I do it because, hey, I know another church member that goes to your church. They do it. You know what they're saying? Somebody else respects it. I respect it. God wants to illuminate and say, really? Is the standard them? Or is the standard me? Well, then there's disrespectable sin. The disrespectable sin is the sin that I don't believe the word. That pastor, he's nuts. You know, I go to church because my friends are there. But be real honest with you, this whole church thing, oh man. No, I want nothing to do with it. Disrespectful sin. Then there's neglectful sin. Sins that, you know, toward the end of the New Testament, it says this, for him to know what is to do good and do it not, that becomes sin. Neglecting what you know you should be doing. Then there's hurtful sin. If you've hurt somebody or have you been hurt, fix that. In other words, if God opens up your heart and says, why do you still hold bitterness against so-and-so? You've neglected to forgive because, by the way, you can't go to heaven. You know this, right? Can I be like completely scriptural? You got to hear this. If you harbor ill will against somebody else and you will not forgive them, you know that God says in His Word, you won't be forgiven yourself. So if there's something in your heart right now that says, I can't forgive him, man, God, illuminate that to me. Then there's the wrestle sense. If you're wrestling with God and you're saying, God, I know what I should be doing, but I'm not going to do it because, you're wrestling with God. God, illuminate that. Open up those things to my heart. See what you accuse and yet excuse in your life. Watch what, okay? Watch what you accuse and yet excuse in your own life. Matthew 7:3. And why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? Guys, it takes courage to pray this prayer. And last, God, check my pathways. That's that phrase, the way of everlasting. What decisions are made without God in the room? This is big stuff. What are the big decisions that you're making that you won't allow God at the table to help you make that decision? You know that's big, right? Hello? You know that's big. So you say, oh God, help me to see if I'm headed in the right direction. God, show me the path, that whole Proverbs 3 thing again. He will guide our paths. See, let God handle what's behind you so you can keep moving forward in what He has ahead of you. Galatians 6:1, dear brothers and sisters, if another believer is overcome by some sin, you who are godly should gently and humbly help that person back into the right path and be careful not to fall into the same temptation yourself. Hey, let me just explain what Paul's saying. Paul's saying this, not only is it important for you to figure out where God is heading you, but you need to help the other people around you in church as they're going through it too. So that means we need to pray together. Christians, you need your brothers and sisters in Christ. That's why we need to pray for each other. Do you know that there are people praying for you right now, you know, in another place in the church? I know sometimes I forget to tell you guys, but we have an intercessory prayer ministry. And that ministry right now is someplace else in the church. You know what they're praying for? Oh, God, help them, because I gave them the sermon outline. And what they do is they look at the sermon outline and they pray based on the sermon. And here's what they're praying for you. God, help them to pray it. Search my heart, oh God. God, look at my heart. Illuminate, Lord, reveal my fears and my sins and my pathway. It's true that if the devil can't make you bad, he'll make you busy. So this prayer is a reality check of your priorities. Now, as Craig Groeschel, who preached along the same lines, said, he said this, all of these prayers that are called dangerous prayers should be anchor prayers. So I'm about to give you the three things that you should anchor your life to. You ready? Number one, anchor your heart to God's heart. You know, what does that mean, Pastor? That means read your Bible, go to church and pray and find out what breaks the heart of God, because it should break your heart too. But yeah, can I get an amen? Thank you, Greg. And not only that, find out what God is passionate about and be passionate about that. You see, if you connect your heart to God's heart, that means this, that you're going to let God purify and cleanse your heart. That's scriptural too. So, Lord, please anchor my heart to your heart. Secondly, anchor my faith to his motives. That means to believe, simply believe that God is good. How many of you believe God is good? Yeah, see, you're going to jump right into that phrase you have known for years. God is good? And all the time? Guess what? Even if you've forgotten why you learned that, it's still good. And you believe that God is good, and so that no matter what you face, as long as you trust him, God is good and faithful, and he will help you through this. Right, Connie? I tell you what, man, I got such a great neighbor. Man, I have learned from this sister of mine. Man, it's good to have great Christian friends. And so what I'm saying is anchor your faith to the motives of God. God loves you. He doesn't have a grudge against you. Somebody wants to say amen. God doesn't have a grudge against you. You wonder why? Because God was working all night to renew the mercy for the next day. So right now, this morning when you woke up, the mercy of God was fresh and new. It wasn't old time and it hadn't got stale. You don't have any mold on it. The mercy of God is available in the morning. That means God says, I love you fresh and new today. I love you, I love you, I love you. Trust his motives. And anchor yourself to those motives. God will not let me down. No matter what. And last, God, I anchor this idea of giving you permission to take your heavenly flashlight and look deep into my soul. Let me close with this. When I was at Ohio Christian University as a student, I actually prayed this prayer. I mean, I know I told you I prayed this week. I prayed this week with a little bit of fear and trepidation, because when I was in college, I prayed it. I was in the chapel. What now is not the chapel. That Daddy Chapel. I was there by myself, and I had just seen some pretty negative things. And that's when I prayed this prayer, thinking it was a spiritual thing. And it was. I knelt at the altar at the chapel, and I said this. God, search my heart. And show me what I need to see. Do I have your attention? 48 hours later, I begged God to stop. And I'm going to tell you why. Little did I know that from the time I got up off my knees that day, that God started showing me the ugly darkness. Man, my mom worked at a nursing home. I went to the nursing home, and all of a sudden I saw families fighting, and I saw the nurses treating. It was just ugly. I was at this nursing home just saying, "Oh God." Then I turned on the news, and there was a bunch of stuff happening, and God was just pouring into me. I mean, it was like drinking from a fire hose. God was sending me sin and darkness that I was seeing in ways that I'd never seen before. And all of a sudden, I had college friends that were acting strangely, and all of a sudden, I felt like, man, what's going on? And then it all hit me. 48 hours later, I realized, God, stop. Please stop. I can't take it anymore. And then here's what God told me. That's what I see. But I filtered it. And I constantly, every day, filter it through grace and mercy. All I'm trying to say, guys, is that if you're brave enough and you want to get to the next level, I mean, going from boys to men, going from girls to women, spiritually speaking. If you want to do that, pray this prayer. And get ready. Because in that same 48-hour period of time, you're, oh man, I'm a college student, Bible college student. I'm in David Case's classes. God showed me my darkness and my blackness. And I realized, oh God, I'm filthy rags. I fell on my knees and said, oh God, stop it. I've forgotten it since. I know that sounded bad. But because I've never forgotten it, I see things differently. I try not to forget that what I see is not at all what God sees. And yet He loves us anyway. Pray the prayer, guys. Pray the prayer. Pray the prayer. Pray the prayer. If it's in your heart to do it, pray the prayer. Because it will take you to a new place. But be sincere. As the praise team, or I guess not. I didn't even instruct them. How many of you know this chorus? Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Let's stand together. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. So melt me, mold me, fill me, use me, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Bow your eyes and heads. That was tough. Nobody looking around. I'd like to ask a question. The room's almost full, man. If you're out there and you're saying, Pastor, I'm telling you, I'm afraid to pray that prayer. Because I know that there's things in my life that I harbor. Pastor, remember me in prayer. Would you raise your hands, please? Amen. I put them down. Hello? If the people who just raised their hands would step out and say, God, I don't care what anybody else thinks. God, I need you. Now, I'm not saying you have to, but what I'm saying, we'd have at least 50 to 75 people at the altar. In fact, in the 845 service, it was almost covered. I mean, there was a lot of people here. We're going to sing that chorus one more time. And if you're somebody that's saying, man, I need to pray, I want you to come. And please know, We would be so celebratory with you if you would step out. Let's sing, Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Come on and join these. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Melt me, mold me, fill me, and use me, Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. The Holy Spirit just checked me. We've got to sing it one more time, guys, because please, please, don't view this as a negative. View this as a godly positive. If you want, right now, those of you that are out there saying, I know I need to pray, come on, step out. Mercy is new today. As we sing it, somebody come. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Amen. So melt me, mold me, fill me, and use me, Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. I tell you, let's give them a round of applause that they stepped up. Amen, amen, amen. Bill Tolbert, I'd like you to come. Would you lead us in prayer this morning? All right, guys, one more time, bow your heads. Let's prepare our hearts for prayer. And for every one of you that raised your hands that did not step out, I want you to know something. You don't have to leave this room. You don't have to leave this room without knowing that the work has been done. So Bill, as you come, you lead us in that prayer, okay? All those who love Jesus, say amen. 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 Bill, you lead us if you would, please.
Heavenly Father, it's with thanksgiving that we come today, thanking you once again that you have met us here in this sanctuary, a safe place. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to us. Thank you for the new mercy that you bring each morning to us. Your grace is sufficient. Thank you for this wonderful message that you gave through your servant today. Thank you for his transparency to share with us of his own life. Father, we sure thank you for our pastor today, our whole team. We thank you for those that have stepped out by faith, knowing that you stand here with your arms open wide to embrace them as they have come. Those that did not have the courage to step out, Lord, help them to realize that wherever they are, right where they stand right now, they too can make that confession to you. Give us the strength, O Lord. We thank you for all that you're doing, continue to do. May our lights not go out in this darkened world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dream.